All right. So today we are going to continue talking about activation of T cells. We saw the details of the signal transduction downstream of signal one last time. And I introduced you to the idea that we needed some other signals, which are listed here as signal two and signal three a little bit. Today we're going to talk about signal two and signal three in more detail. And then at the end, we'll talk a little bit about T cell function, which will also be the main thing that we talk about on Monday. So as I mentioned before, T cell activation requires two signals. So our T cell needs to get a signal from MHC plus peptide through the T cell receptor, as well as CD3 and CD4 or CD8. But our T cell also needs to get a signal through CD28, which is our signal 2 protein, in order to be fully activated. And the ligands that are shown here for CD28 are listed as either CD80 or CD86. Either one of them works. They're two very similar proteins. Those proteins are also known as B7-1 and B7-2. And so sometimes you'll hear B7 instead of CD80 or B7-2 instead of CD86. All of those names are totally fine. We've talked a bit about how our antigen-presenting cell, which is the cell at the top, I point that out because sometimes when we get through the end of all of this, students sometimes will feel some confusion about which things are on the T cell and which things are on the antigen-presenting cell. And if you look at some of the old exams, oftentimes I'll ask you to sort of list which ones are on which cell, and that throws people for a loop. They know, like, B7 binds to CD28, but they can't remember which one's on which cell. So note that as you're looking at figures like this. We know why the antigen-presenting cell presents antigen, but we, of course, also need to think about why that antigen-presenting cell would begin to make CD80 or CD86, our co-stimulatory molecules. And it turns out that this happens because of signaling that comes from PRRs. So the idea here is that if a cell is presenting a foreign antigen, it will be making a co-stimulatory signal as a result of PRR stimulation. If it's presenting a self antigen, there will be no PRR stimulation, and so there will be no co-stimulatory signal. There will be just self antigen. And so this allows the cell to sort of make distinct signals for, I have something foreign that I'm presenting to you, and I have something self that I'm presenting to you. In fact, this was first written about in this paper that I'm kind of obsessed with, that was written in 1989, where someone just proposed what he thought was missing in immunology. It was no data, it was kind of just like, this is what I think we should study. And he basically proposed this whole idea then, and then in 1999, his lab discovered the first PRR. And so he kind of figured it all out, and he kind of calls the next lot of years of immunology in that paper. I love that paper, it's so cool. But the other thing that's really important about this process is that if our T cell is activated with signal 1 through the T cell receptor and signal 2 through CD28, that T cell is activated. If that T cell sees just signal 1 through the T cell receptor without getting ligation and signal through CD28, so signal 1 without signal 2, that T cell is energized. So that T cell is turned off and is no longer able to function. And this is would likely be sort of an autoimmune reaction that was happening in the periphery. And so we don't really want that to happen. We don't want the T cell to be getting a signal from a self antigen. And so we're going to turn that off as a part of peripheral tolerance. And so this is a good way that we sort of enforce making reactions to foreign antigens with the T cell. Yep. So again, just like with the B cell, if it was an absolute overwhelming sledgehammer amount of signal, you could turn it back on. But you should not assume that, you should assume it's off forever unless something really extraordinary happens. And so we need to think for a second just about kind of what's going on here. So if you remember in the thymus, all of the cells that were positively selected and that were able to leave the thymus as mature T cells had to have some sort of low affinity for self antigen. The ones that had high affinity died by negative selection because clearly they were going to be the autoreactive cells. But the ones that had no affinity also died by neglect because they could not even bind MHC. So every T cell has that weak ability to be self-reactive. And the idea here is that that T cell that is binding to, say, the acetylcholine receptor peptide in the thymus, and you can see TVIKESRGTK listed up here, might bind strongly to the polio peptide that's kind of similar. And so we might have weak binding to one peptide, but strong binding to something that's sort of similar. And so this is this idea of cross-reactivity, where our T cell might be weakly reactive to one kind of peptide, but much more strongly reactive to a foreign peptide that it's not seeing. In fact, this is an article in a science magazine called Quanta Magazine. It cites three recent papers. And they actually show that T cells in the periphery bind to self antigens for short periods of time because the binding is weak, but bind to foreign antigens for longer periods of time. And to them, a long period of time is 5 seconds. And that binding actually allows for that extra strength of binding is part of what allows that T cell to be activated. And so, in fact, looking at sort of the biophysics and sort of the chemical biology of this has been something that people are starting to think about. So the idea is that all of these cells are weakly reactive to self-antigen in the thymus and are hopefully going to react strongly to a foreign antigen when they get into the periphery. Obviously, some of them might never respond to a foreign antigen in the periphery. We hope that our T cell that recognizes some Ebola antigen does not ever respond to anything in the periphery. We hope it lives its whole life sad, never finding its antigen. And so there are some that are not ever going to find an antigen, but the idea is that there's going to bind antigens strongly while they bind self weakly. But if something were to sort of slip through the cracks and we were to get strong binding to self in the periphery, that T cell would be energized. Because it was not getting signal 2. Sometimes at this point, people ask, what happens if a T cell gets signal 2 without signal 1? Because here I tell you what happens if you get both and what happens if you get signal 1 only. So sometimes people are like, but what about if you get just signal 2? Nothing. Nothing happens. So the T cell is not activated, but it's also not energized. It sort of goes on about its day. It's just holding hands, sure. One of the reasons why this information is important to know is that if you actually work with T cells in a dish in the lab, so if you work with T cells in vitro, and you want to activate those T cells, it's not enough to give them antigen. If you just give your T cells in a dish antigen, you're going to energize them all, which would probably not be what you're trying to do in your experiment. And so typically, when we want to turn on a T cell, we will use some way of turning on the T cell receptor. There are a few choices there. And we will also use something like an antibody against CD28 that can send a signal through CD28 to give our cell both signals. So we can sometimes use chemicals. So this is a measurement of T cell proliferation. You see that if we give our cell nothing, the cell doesn't really proliferate. If we give our cell a chemical that basically leads to T cell receptor signaling called PHA, we see very little. We give just the CD28, we get very little. This shows another chemical that acts like signal one. It actually stimulates the MAP kinase pathway specifically called PMA. You can see that PMA turns on the cells a little bit. But now you can see if we do PMA plus CD28, we get much better activation because we've given our cells signal one and signal two. We can also use an antibody against CD3 to sort of get around the T cell receptor, turn on all T cells, so we can get some T cell proliferation this way. And if we add in our anti-CD28 to give our T cell signal one and signal two, then we get very good activation. Yep. So the binding to CD3 with the CD3 antibody will actually bring two adjacent T cell receptor clusters next to each other, and that cross-linking usually will allow for some phosphorylations to start. When you do these experiments, every antibody that binds CD3 will not have this activity. Every antibody that binds CD3 will not be what's known as an activating antibody. There are a few different things that these antibodies could do. And so you have to do some testing in the lab to find an anti-CD3 that is an activator. Or now you do some testing on Google to find which ones are known to be activators and just buy that one. So all antibodies against CD3 will not do this, but there are some that will cross-link and lead to signaling. This experiment isn't really measuring energy. It doesn't have a good output to measure energy the way this is set up.
It
could, yeah.
So why wouldn't it in all cells?
Because you don't usually measure energy in a lot of these experiments. Oh, you mean here?
Yeah.
Because some of the antigen-presenting cells in the prep might have been making signal two, and there also were probably some cytokines in the prep. But some of them may be energized, and we can't distinguish that here. So this is one sort of key piece of information that we need to know about co-stimulatory molecules. There is, however, one other big thing we need to think about with co-stimulatory molecules. It turns out that CD28 and B7 are not the only co-stimulatory molecule pair that exist. There's tons of them. This is the table from your textbook that talks about CD28 and B7-1 and B7-2, as well as a bunch of other examples. This is a figure from a review that shows a whole bunch of different examples. I'm not going to talk about every single one, but there are a couple that are really important that I also want to mention. If you look at this figure from the review, one of the things that it shows is the signal coming from signal one. And then you can see all of these other co-stimulatory pairs that could be there. I don't know if there is any sort of situation where every single one of them is there. That would be weird. But you can look at all of them. And what you can notice about all of them is that some of them have a little green plus in the signaling. Those lead to activating signals. They add on to signal one and make it better. But there are others that have little red minuses that are negative signals that actually turn off signaling. And so some of the examples that I need to tell you about have to do with some of this negative signaling as well as the positive signaling. As we will see going forward, we're right now talking about kind of this very beginning part of a T-cell response. When our T-cells first encounter antigen, are starting to divide, are starting to increase in number. But these graphs show you what the overall primary response looks like. You can see that that primary response does peak after, say, 7, 10, 14 days. But what you can also see is that that primary response comes back down. So we eventually will see this phase of contraction of our T cells, where instead of having a huge number of T cells, we'll have slightly fewer. Now, one good thing is at the end, we have more than we had at the beginning. So we have had a net gain in the number of T cells. But we don't have the full expanded number stick around. Many of them die. As I said, this is called the contraction phase. This process is also sometimes known as activation-induced cell death, AICD. This process is actually a really important process for T cells. And one of the reasons is one that you can just generally think about. So you can imagine how many T cell responses you have made up until now in your life. It's probably a pretty good number. And you know that oftentimes when you are sick, when you are making an immune response, your lymph nodes swell up. The reason why your lymph nodes swell is because these cells have divided and divided and divided and made a whole lot of each other. And so this expansion, this huge number of cells, is why your lymph nodes swell, because there's a lot of them. They have to be somewhere. So now let's imagine you had all of those cells from the first infection you ever had when you were a baby. And then from the second infection you ever had, and the third, and all the infections you've ever had for your whole life. By this point in your life, you would just be a walking lymph node. because you would never have gotten rid of the extra ones from any of those previous infections. And in fact, that would be a real problem, because when you tried to make response, I don't know, number 5, there probably wouldn't be any space left for these new T cells. There probably wouldn't be any resources left for them. And so if we kept the full maximum number of all the T cells around, we would never be able to continue making new responses. We would be out of space, out of resources. It would be bad news. And so we have to get rid of this expanded number of cells. Once we're done with them, once the microbe is gone, once the pathogen is gone, we have to get rid of some of these, or else we would never be able to make later responses. When I was in graduate school, we were working on making vaccines. And one of the things we would learn is that there would be some minimum number of T cells that you needed to make the vaccine work. So like if your vaccine got people to have this many T cells, it worked. And we would look at our graph that we made this many, or this is actually my graph from grad school. We'd be like, okay, we gotta get this many T cells at the end. So our goal is we're gonna make them not die. They're gonna be up here, and then they're just gonna not die, and it's gonna be great. And one of the things we learned over and over and over and over again is it's not really possible to make them not die. That process of those cells undergoing activation-induced cell death or contraction is very strongly programmed into the cells. And it's really not something that is sort of easily messed with. Um, And I will show you in a bit later, actually one of the consequences of not having a good contraction response. The reason why I'm telling you about all of this now, because you may be like, why did she suddenly switch from turning T cells on to turning T cells off? Is that what we have learned is that the T cell gets programmed to die eventually when it gets turned on. When you turn on the T cell, part of what happens is actually you're telling the T cell and you're going to die later. And so the activation and the contraction are really, really closely linked. One of the ways that this happens is that we have a co-stimulatory molecule that is important for turning T cells off. So you can imagine that turning T cells on is really good. But if you had T cells on permanently for forever and ever and ever, you would feel pretty awful. You would, you know, be going into something like septic shock where you have massive cytokines all the time in your body and it would be bad. And so in fact, we need to turn T cells off. We need to eventually get rid of them. And the way that we turn T cells off is via a co-stimulatory molecule, just like the way we turn T cells on. And so the first big co-stimulatory molecule I have to tell you about is one that's called CTLA-4. So CTLA-4 turns off T cells. So here on the left, you can see our T cell getting a signal from signal 1 and from signal 2. It gets those two red arrow signals, and the T cell is activated. However, if our T cell gets a signal from signal 1 and instead gets a signal from CTLA-4 and not from CD28, this sends an off signal and turns our T cell off. So this delivers the inhibitory signal to our T cell. What you should notice here is one other critical thing. If you look at CTLA-4, you should notice that CTLA-4 is also binding B7, as is CD28. So CTLA-4's ligand is B7, and CD28's ligand is B7. And so in our cell on the right, CTLA-4 has sort of stolen all the B7s, and we're no longer getting binding to CD28. In fact, CTLA-4 has a much, much, much higher affinity for B7. So if we're in this situation where both CD28 and CTLA-4 are present, the B7 will always bind CTLA-4 and not CD28, and will always lead that T cell to be turned off. So I've kind of implied this, but let's just think about it clearly. On the cell on the left, why is it that the B7 is binding CD28 here and not CTLA-4? Yeah. CTLA-4 is not present in this situation. If CTLA-4 is not present, this is what you get. If CTLA-4 is present, this is what you get. And so, as Mark pointed out, perhaps CTLA-4 has not been transcribed and translated yet in this cell on the left. And that is, in fact, the case. So at the beginning, a T cell is trying to find its antigen. It has no CTLA-4. It gets activated. And in the process of it getting activated, one of the things it does is it starts making CTLA-4. So basically, as we turn our T cells on, one of the things that they do is start making an off switch so that we can't sort of turn them on in excess, have too much signaling, have too much of a T cell response. And so we're actually sort of limiting the time of our response from the very beginning of activating that T cell. Yeah?
So how do they
No, they make none at the beginning. The NFAT and the AP1 and the NF-kappa-B we talked about last time will start transcribing it.
But I thought those are what cause it to, like, get activated.
Those are transcription factors, and they transcribe lots of stuff. I told you they transcribed IL-2, but they actually transcribe lots of stuff. Yeah?
So that, like, net gain of T cells? Though,
mm-hmm. The ones that don't die?
Yeah.
I have this whole dissertation in my office. And what I will tell you is that there are two models, and people like to argue about which of the two models it is.
Okay.
We will talk. So we have a day where we talk about kinetics and memory, and I will tell you about the two models, but it is not decided. And one of my favorite times in grad school was, there was an awesome paper. It's still one of my favorite papers that I read, and it was in this journal. And then if you kept going in the journal, the paper after it was for the other model. Like, the same day in the same journal. Like, so there's good evidence for both of them, and we just can't figure it out. Is the end. The proliferation you can see is happening before CTLA-4 is fully on the cell surface. So you can see the proliferations up here.
So how is that managed to happen? Like, is it transcribed at a later time in activation, or is it, like, does it take a long time to translate? Like, what the fact
is that? Let's go through a few more slides, and then I'll address that. You may also have heard about another co-stimulatory molecule. And enough people have heard of it and asked me questions in this lecture that I actually added it in. I used to not talk about it, but everyone, like, wants to know about it, so here it is. It's called PD-1. So you can see CTLA-4 leading to a negative signal up here. That's on a T cell that's pretty early in its life. However, if our T cell is a little bit older in its life, here it's called an antigen-experienced T cell. That T cell might instead get a kind of signal from a negative co-stimulatory molecule called PD-1. Officially, PD-1 stands for programmed death 1. As I said, this is a way that you can turn off T cells, especially T cells that have been activated previously. This is not sort of that T cell's first time being activated. One of the things that is sort of important about PD-1 is that PD-1 was described to have a key role in a process known as, that's shown here. So I want to think for a second about the T cells. So let's imagine you are a T cell that responds to influenza. Tell me about your life as a T cell that responds to influenza. What are the things that happen to you in your life? Yeah. Okay, you get made. Excellent. Then what? Yeah. You go to lymph node. Okay. Yep. You come in contact with your influenza antigen. Yeah. You get activated. Yep. You do all your activation stuff. Yeah. Hold on. We haven't got... Okay. So you get rid of the influenza. You fight the influenza. You get rid of it. And then perhaps you die, right? Or let's imagine you don't die right then. What do you...
You wait a bit.
What do you do while you're waiting a bit? You're really taking my metaphor the wrong way right now. You're really not helping me. Okay, now I'm going to ask this question a slightly different way. Let's imagine you are a college student. I know this is a really hard one to imagine. So first, you, like, learn a bunch of stuff, like you're a T cell. And then you, like, have the battle, like the exam, you know, right? And then what happens after you take the exam? We are not anticipating death. No. What do you do as soon as you finish taking your exam? What do? You go take a nap. You relax. You're like, phew, I'm done. And so you chill and you go to a state of rest. And in fact, if you are a T cell after you fight flu, you then say, phew, I'm done. And you go to a state of rest. Once upon a time, when I gave this example, I said you go and lay in your hammock. And then I laid across the table on the front of the room. But seeing as how I'm not feeling well today, I'm afraid I might not get back up. So no hammock today. Okay. Now, we're going to imagine this a slightly different way. You are not a T cell that fights the flu anymore. Now you're a T cell that fights HIV. What's different? What's the problem, Tara? You don't get rid of HIV. There's never a time when HIV is gone. It is an antigen that is chronic. It is there forever. And so what does that mean? No sleeping. No hammock. No nap. How do you feel at that point?
Sad.
And how?
Exhausted.
You feel exhausted. And so in fact, there is a phenomenon that is called T cell exhaustion. See, when I got there with the metaphor, it made sense. And there's no contemplating of the death. None of it. No. So if we have a situation where there is chronic infection, where our antigen persists for a long period of time, our T cells start to undergo this process of chronic exhaustion. They go from being able to do lots of functions to being able to do fewer and fewer and fewer functions, and finally they can do no functions. And they actually may undergo apoptosis. And this process, we have seen, is related to how much PD-1 they have. So PD-1 tends to be on more exhausted T cells. I like thinking about chronic exhaustion. It's an interesting idea. But one of the reasons why thinking about chronic exhaustion might be of interest to you is, spoiler alert, some immune cells do stuff about cancer. We're going to talk about that later. If there are, say, T cells that are responding to tumors, those T cells very frequently end up in a state of chronic exhaustion because they are battling for a very long period of time. One of the things that we see in a lot of cancer patients is that while in theory their immune system could deal with that tumor, it is in an exhausted state. This is true not only of tumors, but of a number of different chronic states. And so a group of individuals has come up with two different medications that deal with this process. One of them is an antibody that binds to CTLA-4. In this case, this antibody does not lead to signaling. In this case, it's more like a neutralization thing. When CTLA-4 is bound by the antibody, it cannot bind its ligand anymore. And so now our T cell never gets an off signal and permanently is getting on signals. If getting too much of an inhibitory signal is the problem, say if our T cell is somewhat in an exhausted state and part of its exhaustion is due to too much CTLA-4, B7 interaction, if we treat with this antibody, we stop those negative signals and we actually allow that T cell to get positive signals and suddenly be able to kill the tumor. Yep.
How long does that last before chronic exhaustion sets in?
Well, the chronic exhaustion is generally happening through CTLA-4 or through PD-1, so you're blocking it to not let it happen. They seemed, you're basically blocking them from being allowed to nap. These treatments are probably less than 5 years old, so they seem okay, and they seem to do really well for the patients. Ideally, what we're hoping for is that the immune system is going to kill the tumor. We're going to get the tumor completely gone, and then you can stop the inhibition. And so you're really hoping it's going to be a short period of time. You're hoping the patient's not going to be on it for the rest of their lives. Yeah?
So, I'm confused about one thing.
Okay. Because you carefully chose from all of the different CD28 or CTLA-4 antibodies to find one that either is activating or is blocking. It is probably due to the epitope that is bound on CTLA-4 and how the interaction is and sort of like what direction it binds, it moves CD28 in the cell membrane kind of thing. But at this point, it is done empirically. You test antibodies until you find one that is a blocker or an activator. Similarly, there are antibodies against PD-1 or PD-L1 that can be used to block the exhaustion reaction that we see in a T cell. So our T cell might be, as listed here, reinvigorated and suddenly have the ability to refight a tumor. These two drugs won the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2018, which is also kind of why I added them to lecture last year. The two most famous PD-1s are Opdivo and Keytruda, or pembrolizumab. So if you've heard of somebody going on pembro, that's a PD-1 blockade. So Keytruda or Opdivo, they're used for cancer treatments as well as a bunch of other things, and we're going to see some of them later in the semester. But hopefully you can see how they are related to co-stimulation T-cell activation now. This review is coming from.
So is there like a specific type of cancer that these are used for more than others, or is it just kind of?
No, it's just kind of a cancer drug. It's just, they decided to write a review about it that had a picture that I liked. Yeah.
So if a tumor doesn't respond to this, what's the problem?
Then, how much of my cancer immunology lecture can I give you now? There are multiple reasons why the T cells might not be working. Exhaustion is only one of them. And so there might be a different problem with the T cell response. Or the tumor might be sort of so aggressive that it doesn't matter if the immune system can get to it or not. So it could be either of those things. And so everything that I've just told you about has to do with signal 2, the co-stimulatory interaction that happens for T cell activation. We also have to talk a little bit about signal 3, which is really the cytokine that the T cell is receiving. And so when our T cell is activated, it is going to receive some cytokines. Those cytokines might be involved in proliferation. Those cytokines can be involved in differentiation, so pushing the cell down different sort of paths of activation, or things like that. The different paths part is going to be really important when we talk specifically about CD4 T cells, and that's really going to be Monday. Here, we're not going to really worry about paths. We're just going to worry about one cytokine. And the one cytokine that we are going to worry about is the one that's shown here, which is IL-2. IL-2 can be made by a T cell and signal back to that same T cell in autocrine to help that T cell. If there was another nearby T cell, it could also signal to it in paracrine, but that is not drawn on this figure. We already heard a bit about making IL-2. Transcribing IL-2 was the goal of the signaling we saw last time. In that we had to get our T cell making NFAT, AP1, and NF-kappa B. And those three transcription factors combine together to transcribe IL-2. This protein IL-2 is known as a T cell growth factor. So when it was actually originally named, before it was named IL-2, it was called TCGF, T cell growth factor. And so IL-2 really has two big things that it does for our T cell. One of them is it pushes it to proliferate. And so now we're going to see our T cell going through cell cycle rounds and making many copies of itself. That's how we get that nice expansion that gives us those nice swollen lymph nodes, is because of that proliferation. And so you can see our T cell will start to do proliferation. Our T cell is going to get a signal to survive at this point, because T cells always love a signal to survive. And our T cell is also going to get a signal that is going to help that cell differentiate. And so that cell is going to change its function somewhat and now actually get to do the things that T cells do. It's now kind of a fully grown T cell that's ready to go out and do some T cell functions because of that differentiation. IL-2 was the first cytokine described that is a member of a family of cytokines. And so this is the family of cytokines that IL-2 is a member of. I also have a lengthy dissertation on this one. The same dissertation I told you before, in fact, talks about this sort of thing. So this family of cytokines includes IL-2, IL-4, IL-7, IL-9, IL-15, and one that's not shown here called IL-21. They all have some structural similarities in terms of the cytokines, but the reason why I'm presenting all of them to you and telling you about this family is that they all share in common part of their receptor. So you can see that all of these cytokines have either two proteins, two chains that come together to make a receptor, or three. And one of the chains is common to all of those receptors. It's called the gamma chain. It's sometimes called the common gamma chain, or CD132. And so this is known as the common gamma chain family of cytokines because they all signal through this receptor. You will notice that one of them is IL-7, which we learned about with developing B cells and T cells. It was a really important survival signal for them. IL-4 does a bunch of things that are important for B cells as well as T cells. IL-15 is important for a bunch of T cells and NK cells. IL-9 is really important for mast cells. IL-21 is important for T cells, B cells, it's important for all sorts of things. Read the dissertation. and IL-2 is really important, especially for T cells. One of the reasons why this is so important is that one very common immunodeficiency is a defect in the common gamma chain receptor. And so there are people who have mutations where they do not make this protein, this gamma chain. And what that means is they have no IL-2 receptor. They have no IL-15 receptor. They have no IL-7 receptor. They have no IL-9 receptor. They have no IL-4 receptor. And they have no IL-21 receptor. And so they are profoundly immunocompromised because their developing B cells and T cells are messed up, and their mast cells and their NK cells. And basically, they have no adaptive immune system. The gamma chain is encoded on the X chromosome. So this is most commonly found in boys, where you'll see having one mutated copy along with the Y chromosome. So if you've ever heard of X-linked SCID, X-linked severe combined immunodeficiency, the boy in the bubble, that's what he had, is a lack of that protein chain. Yeah?
So with the treatment options for that, isn't it like a bone marrow?
So your best option for treatment in that case is a bone marrow transplant where you get bone marrow that has common gamma chain. And so now suddenly you're going to basically regrow an immune system that will be able to respond to these cytokines. You can see that the IL-2 receptor is shown here as having three different chains, alpha, beta, and gamma. alpha by itself has relatively low affinity for IL-2 and is sometimes called the low affinity receptor. If we have just beta and gamma, we do have some affinity for IL-2. We have sort of intermediate affinity. And when we have all three chains together, it is the high affinity receptor. In the beginning, our T cell, first, it doesn't even make IL-2. It just makes the moderate affinity receptor. It makes beta gamma. Then our T cell will start making IL-2. It will signal through this moderate affinity receptor, and that will lead to more signaling that will make the T cell now start to make alpha and have a high affinity receptor. And so then it can really grab all the IL-2. You might imagine, Mark, that this type of signaling might be important for CTLA-4, because CTLA-4 does come in after the proliferation, and so perhaps, I don't know the CTLA-4 transcription story perfectly, but perhaps it needs this signal as well, you could imagine, to really get CTLA-4 made. And so our activated T cell will have that high affinity receptor, our naive T cell will have the low affinity receptor. This cytokine receptor, like other cytokine receptors, will signal through the shockingly named cytokine signaling pathway. You guys remember we talked a little bit about receptor tyrosine kinases. We talked about RAS MAP kinase last time. And I told you that if you remember, and so with receptor tyrosine kinase, you can kind of remember there's like three important parts: the receptor, the tyrosine, and the kinase. And with RAS MAP kinase, you can kind of remember like you gotta have a RAS and you gotta have a MAPK. Like, pretty easy. The cytokine signaling pathway is another one everybody loves, because if you remember the name of it, you know it. Cytokine receptors have multiple chains. Here you see one that has two chains. IL-2 receptor has three. Doesn't really matter for us right now. Those chains act as receptors. And they are bound by another partner protein, which is a kinase. This kinase is known as JAK. So JAK stands for Janus kinase. Janus. Have you ever heard of Janus?
Like the Roman god.
Like the Roman god, yes. What's the deal with Janus? Okay, what's the other guy? There's a key thing about Janus. Choice between two, which is? He has two faces. Janus has two faces. And this kinase, the Janus kinase, you're going to like this, I promise. There's a great thing about JAK. So the Janus kinase has two regions. One where it can bind a phosphate, and one where it can add phosphates. And so the idea was it's named Janus kinase because it has these two functions. And when the JAKs phosphorylate one another, and then they make binding sites for one another. So the JAKs phosphorylate one another and make these great binding sites. It's two faces, the Janus kinase. And if you ask a super old immunologist, super old, they will tell you that story is total crap. That the Janus kinases were first found in some patients with immunodeficiencies, and they thought they had found like this super interesting new receptor that like told them all about the immune system. And then they started to study this protein they found, and they were cranky, because what they had found was just another kinase. And so old people say JAK stands for just another kinase. but the textbooks say it stands for Janus kinase because of the Roman god Janus. Because and comes up, they come up with this whole fancy thing. Once the JAKs have been phosphorylated and have these new binding sites, they're able to allow binding by another set of proteins called the STATs. The STATs get phosphorylated. They also will dimerize. And once STATs are active and dimers, they are actually active transcription factors and can go straight to the nucleus and induce transcription. So this pathway that is involved in cytokine signaling is known as the JAK-STAT pathway. It has a receptor, JAK and STAT. That's it. So that's why people usually like the JAK-STAT pathway, because they can remember all the things in it. In reality, there are multiple JAK proteins and multiple STAT proteins. And so the combination of JAKs and the combination of STATs that are used in any particular receptor and in any particular response dictate the transcriptional response that is seen. This is just showing you with kind of one general JAK and one general STAT. But there really are multiple of them. At the beginning, our T cell has that sort of more moderate affinity T cell receptor. Eventually, that cell will start to make IL-2. That will induce a nice strong signal that will start making more receptor and more IL-2 as a positive feedback loop. And eventually, our cell will undergo mitosis and make many copies of itself so that it's now ready to do its response. IL-2 has also been shown to have a critical role in contraction. I'm not going to go through the role of IL-2 in contraction, but it's actually pretty cool. But there is one other piece I need to tell you about with regard to contraction. And I will say that, two or three slides that is always this question of where in the heck do they go? There's a reason why I put them here, but so it might you might feel like it's weird, but there is a reason, I promise. And this has to do with sort of the biology of contraction and turning off T cells. When our T cells die, we refer to that process as activation-induced cell death, AICD. And if we look in detail at those cells are dying by apoptosis. So it's a programmed form of cell death. So we're going to see our cell undergoing apoptosis, which, if you remember from Bio250, requires some signaling with things like, you know, caspase 3 and caspase 9 and the apoptosome, aka the pinwheel o' death, all that good stuff. So that is what's happening in these cells when they are undergoing contraction. Specifically, when they are undergoing contraction, a T cell that is going to undergo contraction actually gets a signal through a protein called FAS. So when a T cell is activated, it will have FAS on its surface. FAS is a trimer. It leads to some signaling. First, we activate caspase 8. Then we can see activation of the mitochondrial apoptosis pathway. Eventually, we'll get our happy pinwheel of death, our caspase 3 and caspase 9, all of the things that you've learned about before. As a result of this FAS interaction, when FAS interacts, it interacts with a protein called FAS ligand, which tells the cell, you have to die now. And so that induces death in our cells. This is a key part of the contraction of those cells. And there are patients who have mutations in either FAS or FAS ligand, and so who do not make either FAS or FAS ligand. Those patients have a condition known as ALPS, or autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome. And what you can see is that these are the lymph nodes in those patients. They're basically permanently enlarged. Those patients are actually having permanent immune responses because their T cells don't contract. And they're generally in sort of cytokine storm conditions. They are in very bad shape. They do not tend to live for particularly long. I think the lighting doesn't allow it, but you can actually see the lymph nodes on this little girl's back, like all over her back, because they're so swollen, on her neck, all things like that. This is what happens if contraction does not occur. We do see patients that have defects in either FAS or FAS ligand, which is clearly quite problematic. So all of the things I've told you about are activation of T cells. Yep. The treatment that would make the most sense is radiation to get rid of the problematic T cells and then bone marrow transplant. The problem is that would only get rid of sort of the rapidly dividing cells with FAS, and so you would probably see other manifestations because FAS is not only going to be found in some immune cells. There are some other cells that are going to be a problem too. It would also be a question of whether it's FAS or FAS ligand. That's your problem. All of that information has to do with our T cells in the periphery. So at this point, we have seen our T cell interact with an antigen-presenting cell and see antigen. And that T cell has gotten some signals. That T cell has started making IL-2, which it has fed to itself to allow it to undergo clonal expansion and proliferate and make way more copies of itself. So we've had activation. We've had clonal expansion. That cell also is now going to be able to differentiate and actually start to do some sort of function. For the rest of the time today, I'm going to talk specifically about the functions of CD8 T cells. We're going to ignore the top half with the CD4 T cells. We'll deal with them on Monday. But today, we're going to think about the CD8s. So at the beginning, this CD8 T cell is called a CD8 T cell. It doesn't really have much of an ability to do too many things. However, after differentiation, our T cell gains a new name. It is now called a CTL, or a cytotoxic T lymphocyte. And after this differentiation, our cell is now able to kill infected cells and do some sort of effector function now in the peripheral tissue instead of in the secondary lymphoid organ. So our CTL will first see its antigen on perhaps a dendritic cell in the lymph node. You can see that we will have proliferation and make many copies of that CTL in the lymph node. Those cells will then leave the lymph node and traffic through the rolling activation stopping pathway that we saw before to go to the place where actual infection is. And that CTL will be able to specifically kill infected cells while leaving the neighboring cells intact. So we'll see specific killing of those infected cells. One reason why this differentiation is important is if this cell kills upon first seeing antigen, it would kill the dendritic cell that was trying to activate it. And that would be bad. That would also mean no other T cell would get activated, because here, this dendritic cell could maybe activate a few T cells. But if we immediately killed it, that would be bad. In theory, that T cell could even have killed the thymus. All of those things are bad. So we want that T cell to get some signaling, like all the signals we just talked about, to allow it to differentiate, to have its killing activity. Our T cell is specific in its ability to kill its target cell. Our T cell is able to kill more than one cell. So you can see that this cell, first it kills this guy, and then it moves on and kills another one. And so it's not like a one-to-one thing. An activated T cell can kill many infected cells. Yep, Mark. CD8 binds to class 1.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And so this is probably going to be a cytosolic antigen, probably going to be a virus. The link on that slide takes us here. whole thing. All right, so what they've done is you have these little circular cells are going to be the T cells. They're going to move around. The long, skinny cells are going to be the target cells. And this is in a media that has a dye. So if the outside, if the membrane of the cell gets compromised, then the dye rushes in and the cell gets colored. So the cell starts out clear and the cell will get a color if it's going to die, if its membrane has been compromised. And so you can watch this process here. So here comes a T cell. It touches the other cell and boom. and one thing that you can notice is, oh, see that cell just hit another one. It does, there may be a little bit of intake when the T cell is doing some secretion. It's having a party because it killed everything. I don't know. I don't know. I'm going with parties. So we can see this T cell performing its recognition and killing function. There are a couple of ways mechanistically that the T cell actually is able to kill its target cell. One of the ways that the T cell can kill its target cell is through Fas ligand interactions. That's why I just told you. That's why I put those weird slides that I don't know where to put before this, because then you've heard of Fas. So our T cell can have Fas ligand, our infected cell can have Fas, and the CD8 T cell can use its Fas ligand to interact with Fas on the target cell and lead to apoptosis of the target cell via the mechanism I showed you before. CTLs also contain some vesicles or some granules that are full of toxic things. And so we can see cytotoxic granules being released. This is an example of directional secretion. So the cell does not secrete its cytotoxic granules at all 360 degrees. It actually does that secretion towards the target cell. It moves the granules towards the target cell and secretes. If you remember with our T cell receptor and our immune synapse, there were some integrins that were sort of forming a little wall for the signaling that also forms a little wall so that the toxic stuff can only go between the T cell and the target cell and not diffuse randomly and kill other things as bystanders. Yep. It's a sphere, yeah. And so we have these granules, these lytic granules that will be released from the T cell to the target cell, leading to the death of the target cell. And you can see that again here in the version from your textbook. The CTL has a bunch of granules. It will target the target cell. It will move all the granules to be by the target cell. It will then secrete the toxic products that will lead to apoptosis of the target cell. The CTL will move on and perhaps kill another target cell. And so we will see this process of the CTL being able to kill multiple target cells. Yep?
So what determines by which process the T cell kills?
Honestly, it usually tries to do them all. there are two major things that are in those cytotoxic granules. One of them is a protein called perforin. Perforin makes pores in membranes. It perforates them. And so you can actually see these perforin pores that are made on the surface of the target cell. This can cause issues with water homeostasis in the cell. It also can actually allow in some of the other toxic products. So there are other toxic products that can get into the cell because of these perforin pores. A fabulous immunology secret is that the perforin pore and the membrane attack complex pore structurally look very similar. And in fact, in most electron microscopy images like that, they just pick and tell you which one it is, but they don't actually know. so So this was perforin, I guess. Another of the major, there are actually lots of things in those cytoplasmic granules. The other one I want to tell you about is one called granzyme B. Granzyme has zyme at the end. That tells you it's an enzyme. It's in fact the enzyme that's found in the granule, so it's granzyme. Granzyme B usually slips into the cell through the perforin pore, and it is able to just cleave caspase 3 and direct the cell directly to apoptosis, skipping all these other steps. It can cleave some other molecules to accelerate all the other parts of apoptosis too, but its biggest thing that it will do is actually cleave caspase 3, which is the executioner caspase, and lead that cell directly into cell death. One final thing I will say about CTLs is that CTLs do also release a lot of other products. The most common or most famous of them is a cytokine interferon gamma. And so sometimes when CD8 T cell responses are being measured, we actually are measuring the interferon gamma responses from the T cells. So interferon gamma is an important thing that comes from CD8 T cells. And finally, in order for a CD8 T cell to be the best ever differentiated CD8 T cell, it has to get help from a CD4. And so I have to tell you about CD4s on Monday. Ta-da.